Your breakfast over. Okay, well, if you haven't, it's too late anyway. And please be on time 1 o'clock for lunch so we can get that out of the way. But this morning, our first speaker tells me that for most of his life he's been a theosophist. Well, I said I wouldn't hold that against him. A former president of the SPR on two occasions, Professor Ellison is a well known speaker. Many of you may have seen him on television. Can you hear all right at the back? It's not me you want to hear anyway, it's him. But if you can't hear, as I said last night, put your hand up and then he'll speak up a bit. He's a member of the Scientific and Medical Network, one of the founders, I believe, of that.
No, I'm not.
And he's been heavily involved in all aspects of parapsychology and the paranormal for about 40 years. Well, same as me, really. and he's going to speak this morning on some experiences and thoughts on physical mediumship of 40 years ago. So will you give a good Noah's Ark welcome as I commend to you Professor Arthur Ellison.
George, ladies and gentlemen, may I say first what a great pleasure and honour it is to be invited to talk to the Noah's Ark Society. I've been looking forward with enormous pleasure to this morning, and I just hope that to what I have to say will be of interest to you. I should explain that I have a scientific approach to this subject. People often ask me what I believe. You know, you've been studying this subject for 50, 60 years. What do you believe? And I explain always, I'm not in the belief business. I don't have beliefs. I'm interested in the evidence and how strong it is. And I'm very happy to discuss the evidence. And of course, scientific people study the evidence and do tests on the evidence and very often find that it doesn't stand up under tests. In other words, they find that what they believed earlier simply is not quite true. Very often it's a partial truth. So I find as I get older that I'm certain about less and less. The older I get, the less certain I am about anything. And the most important thing that I study these days is consciousness. The basis of our subject is consciousness, I shall be talking about particular aspects of that this morning. I shall be giving you some facts. Facts are experiences, which are purely mental, of normal people. I mean, people who are not mentally unbalanced or something. Facts are the experiences of normal people. Amongst my experiences are quite a few physical seances, so I shall describe a typical seance I attended in the late 1950s, and then I shall give you some thoughts about it based on many experiences and many kinds that I've had since. And I said earlier, I'm particularly interested in consciousness. Let's talk about science first. How do we use science to order, that is, model our experiences? Most of us are realists. Now, what a realist is somebody who believes that we are surrounded by objects in three dimensions of space and one of time. They're out there, independent of ourselves. Even the chairman is out there, independent of me. I don't know what he'll do next. We're surrounded by these objects, and we can examine these objects through the five senses and in no other way. That is the belief of a realist. And most normal scientists, and I'm not a normal scientist, neither are the others, most normal scientists are realists. They think there is nothing else but these objects around us, that they are their physical body. There is no way of examining anything other than through the five senses. And the input goes into this computer in the top, and that's all there is to us. And when we're dead, we're dead. That's a normal scientist, a normal realist. But most of us are realists most of the time. The very language we use is based on realism. Remember, that's a technical philosophical term meaning what I just described. Our very language is based on realism, that these objects are out there and we react with them and to them through the five senses and in no other way. So the important thing here is our very language is based on realism. Our language is dualistic, as the philosophers would say. Two things are involved. Things out there, an object out there, and ourselves here, and we react. There's a reaction between us. That is the basis of our language. Our language is dualistic. Subject, an object, and a verb, a relationship between them. But you know, jumping right to the end, this isn't really a dualistic universe. The evidence is awfully good that we're all one, really, and that it's part of this illusory state that we're in at the moment. Charles Todd calls it a consensus illusion. We're all in a sort of waking dream at the moment. We're not in the real world at all. We are as we feel ourselves to be, and communicating through our five senses. And it's very important to realize that right at the beginning. All we can ever have are mental experiences. If you describe your mental experiences as due to some object out there which you are perceiving through your eyes and so on, we can all explain this because we were taught, that is conditioned, that that is what the facts are. We were taught this at school. So that is the basis of our experience. We have only mental experiences. You know, spending a few seconds on this, what we were taught at school, rays of light reflected from objects into the eyes, inverted image on the retina, electrochemical pulses going to the back of the brain, the so-called visual cortices, and the story ends there. That's no sort of explanation of how we appear to be looking out through two little windows in the front of the computer. If we're only the computer, how can we look out through windows anyway? It's a very inadequate model, realism. And I know that we wouldn't be here if we thought it was adequate. So it's very important to realize that we are making mental models, and we start doing it at birth. A baby, newly born, and perhaps several weeks after, doesn't realize that it's separate from anything else. It's just oneness. It has experiences in its mind, whatever that may mean, and they're a complete model. It can't make sense of them. And its parents start straight away conditioning it. That's an object out there, that's the moon, that's Delhi, and so on. And that object wiggling about there is part of you, that's your toe. And we're conditioned in this way right from the start of our lives to think that there are real objects out there independent of ourselves, and we are here observing them through the five senses, and that's the lot. That's the whole story. And then various other authority figures following our parents condition us in this way. We are taught about normal Western science, at least most of us are, at school and perhaps at college later on. We are thoroughly conditioned to this theoretical mental model that we call the physical world, which makes sense of our experiences. And we tend to think this is reality. It isn't. It's just a mental model. we don't have anything else but mental models. Some people are psychic and have other mental experiences, rather different from those of us who are not psychic. And they also make a mental model. And they too are conditioned by other people. Many psychics I know couldn't make any sense of their experiences until they wandered into a spiritualist church. And somebody there started their conditioning and explained the mental model that they have, which patterns and orders and makes sense of their experiences, which are different from the rest of us having only five senses. So it's very important to realize that we have a lot of mental models. And what we scientists are doing, this is our business, is testing those mental models to destruction. And when we are able to test a mental model to destruction, then we've got some more facts of experience in which we can build a better mental model. So those of us who are scientific in this business are trying to test the mental models that we have to destruction and then make better ones which will work better, which will predict what is going to happen in the future to us better. If we are healers, then maybe it will enable us to have more effective healing. Healing that we hope will occur nearly every time instead of perhaps fairly rarely. If we have a mental model involving some sort of energy or power, prana, ki, chi, whatever you call it, going through our hands into a subject, we have a mental model like that, and we imagine that that subject has a physical body and an etheric double, at least that's what I learned as a young theosophist, and an astral body and various other bodies too, then that's the model we have, and sometimes it works, it gets rid of the headache or other pain, sometimes it doesn't. Why is that? Well, it's up to those of us who have a scientific approach to try to find out why. And if we think that that etheric double is semi-physical, interpenetrating the physical body and perhaps slightly sticking out all around, and the astral body similarly, only equaler, but sticking out more than more all around, if we have a model like that, then we can test that model. And I tested it 30 or 40 years ago. I've always found spiritualists very, very willing, friendly and helpful to us scientists. And I went along to the SAGB many years ago and I found lots of mediums who were willing to help me do tests like that. And I found that the etheric double is not in physical space. So what is it you're feeling when you're feeling etheric balls of energy? Well, any first-year psychology student will explain the results of suggestion. This is suggestion. So there are other ways of modeling, patterning and ordering the experiences that we have, other than those that we were taught when we first came into this subject. And many of those models are wrong, and it's up to all of us who want to improve those models, and if we're healers, improve our rate of healing, to read the literature and find out about the tests that have been made and see if we can improve our rate of healing. That's why. I suppose all of us are in this business, I certainly am. And I know David Fontana very well, and the same applies to him. We're in this business because we want to help humanity. We're all of us here stuck up using our normal mental Western model. We are here on a little planet and we suffer a lot. We occasionally have happy times too, and we've got to help each other. And that's why we are trying to discover the truth about all this. The truth about our consciousness. Psychic and religious people then also have mental models. The Archbishop of Canterbury has got a mental model. You'd think it was a bit oversimplified to say his model represents an old man up in the sky, who when you pray to him will alter the laws of nature, so-called, he'd say that was a bit simplistic. But nevertheless, all religious people of all religions, and psychic people, and the rest of us, all have mental models, patterning and ordering the many experiences that we have. And we scientists then, just summarizing this last little bit, try to falsify, if we can, those mental models. If we can't falsify them, then we go on using them. I mean, if the models work well, then you go on using them until they stop working. I'm an electrical engineer and I use Maxwell's equations for electromagnetic fields. But I don't think an electromagnetic field is a real object out there. It's a metaphysical abstraction. Using Maxwell's equations, I can design electric machinery that works. And we all know what that means. And it's very useful. So I'm a pragmatist too. But I'm also a classical idealist. An idealist, again, that's another philosophical, technical term. An idealist is someone who thinks there is nothing but ideas. In other words, thoughts in our minds. There is nothing but ideas. Our physical body, the world out there, the etheric bubble, the astral world, chakras, all the rest of it, prana. All these are ideas in our minds. And we have mental models patterning and ordering them. And those mental models don't always work. And if we have a scientific approach, we test them and we try to improve them. Before I came to London, which was in 1958, I lived in Rugby then, designing large electric machines. Before then, I used to come up to London once a week on Sunday to attend seances in Battersea. That was from about 1953 to about 1960. I was wandering around Foyle's bookshop one day and I found a book in the second-hand department describing remarkable physical phenomena which it said were going on in Battersea. I didn't know whether these were still going on. You don't know quite how long the books have been there, do you? So I wrote to the author, and I got a reply quite soon. I said, if you're still having your seances, please may I come? And he was delighted to invite me. So I went to physical seances in a little room in Battersea for a whole year. Every Sunday afternoon I travelled down to London, was entertained to tea, the seance was in the evening, and I was sometimes lucky to catch the milk train back to Rugby. And I'm going to give you one or two extracts from my file of notes on these seances, and then I shall say a few things about them. This was held in the home of someone I would describe as, this doesn't apply to anybody here, a rabid spiritualist. A literal, simple believer. If you didn't believe it, you were not welcome. So I have to be a bit careful how I talk. So I'll describe what followed now literally, and I shall omit such terms as it appeared to be, and ostensibly, and things like that. I'll just describe it literally. The circle assembled, ready. The medium came. He was often not too sober. Sometimes he couldn't get up the stairs, in which case we didn't have a seance, but usually he got up the stairs. He sat in the cabinet. That was a chair in the corner with a curtain, which was never drawn. A red light was on. That means a 60-watt lamp with a red handkerchief tied around it. Not quite a rotten filter, I'd say to my fellow scientists. During this seance, we had the medium and eight sitters, which I was one. Now, I'll just describe what happened. A red Indian guide, great white feather, opened, and speaking through the medium in trance, he said, "Greetings, my children. It is I, great white feather. I come unto you with the blessing of the spirit world and the great white spirit, whose loving power joined you all together in his heavenly name. We come unto you that we may help and aid thee in your spiritual progress. We come that each day and each night we may help you on this path to perfect enlightenment. The great white spirit gives unto all his divine healing power. He gives and shares his blessings, the treasures of heaven, unto each one of you. Your spirit guides are forever continuing to attract the children of the earth that remain in the shadows onto the warmth of his holy light. I pray you to cherish the blessings and gifts from the heavenly kingdom of the spirit world, and I, great white feather, pray that each one of you will go forth with the work of the great white spirit. I bless you, fare thee well, great white feather, peace be unto you. That was the opening. Grey Horse, another Indian guy, then controlled the medium, like an Indian, rose from the chair, the medium. I bless you all, he said, then shook our host by the hand. Grey Horse, I bless you. Went all round the circle, shaking everybody's hand. I have come for a purpose, very good purpose. I am spirit guide. I guide those who go in mist. I help, rescue. Guide to path of light that leads to spirit world. I give you blessing, peace to you. A third communicator gave the name of Joan Woodhouse. Excuse me coming like this. I did ask permission to come. I did not come on my own. I have come here with a guide. Now I know, you see. I told you the spirit world would put everything all right. Joan Woodhouse, I told you. That man was not responsible for my passing. The spirit world is going to put it all right. He will be quite all right. He did not have anything to do with it. I told you weeks ago, it is not the only reason for my coming through. It will help to prove survival. I told you several weeks ago that he had nothing to do with it, and it will be proved. Grey Horse is calling me now. I must go. I will come again if I may. The medium's expression then altered. Greetings, honorable daughters, greetings, honorable sons, Long Fu. Yes, I am very happy to officiate during this service. I take control. No earthly light. Blessings. Our host then switched off the light, and we were in pitch darkness. After a short interval, the plaques went up, and we saw our first materialized form. I must explain that the plaques were two pieces of plywood, each about 8 inches square, carrying a handle on the back, and the fronts were painted with fluorescent paint. They'd been propped up in front of a light all the afternoon to make them bright. First materialized form, Hassan. He came and looked closely into the face of one of the sitters, whose chief control he was. Blessings upon thee, my son, and upon thee, my daughter. I come to tell thee I have found the land upon which thy house and temple will stand. Upon it I have placed my blessing and anointed it with holy water. Now I await the great white spirit to direct me further. Then with thee I will remain to build. Peace to thee. Hassan then greeted all the other members of the circle. Peace to thee, I bless thee, my children. He then disappeared down through the floor, and the plaques cluttered down onto the carpet. So the materialized figures went on. Another bearded Eastern character was next, with more blessings and promises of wonderful things waiting. The next one came self-illuminated. He seemed to have illuminated hands, shining light on himself, another Eastern character. Peace, peace to thee, I come to thee once again. Thou wilt sup at the master's table. The next one was the spirit wife of our host. She was the one the book was about that I found in foil. She also came self-illuminated and dressed in a nun's costume. She called out Bud to her husband. See, I've come. I've come in the purple ray. I've come with a lot of spiritual children because today is Sophie's birthday on Earth. So we have allowed the spiritual to gather flowers and to bind them up for each one of you. I bless you all. The radiance dimmed and white rose, as our host called her, disappeared. Well, what on earth does come in the purple rain mean? Nobody even seemed to wonder, which surprised me a bit. Sophie was next heard chatting in the cabinet. How many are you? Eight. All right, kids, I want eight bunches of flowers. Now another nun appeared. She helped Sophie bring the flowers. We all had a bunch of apported flowers. Marvellous things were happening all the time. So it went on for some 3 hours. Another Indian, brown owl, was the next figure, then the squaw of great white feather, etc., etc. Lady Jane Seymour, the special helper of one of the sitters, then appeared, who told her that the ring she had received at the last seance was highly magnetized. I didn't dare suggest that I put my compass needle in it. She said, I have returned that I may now work with the magi for the apportion of objects. Well, what, nobody worried about what highly magnetized means at all. It didn't seem to concern them. This greatly surprised me. On this occasion, King George V was the last visitor. I should explain, all these materialized forms looked exactly as they ought to. King George V said, I have joined the band of great power. I have come to tell you that Mary and I will work with you for this special religion. As he was going, King George V said, I have come in a dark suit. On another occasion, Sir Oliver Lodge appeared, looking exactly like his photographs, you know, a big bald head and enormous white bushy beard. He also went round the circle, showing himself with the plaques, you know, picked them up, held them so that we could see them and talk to them. I could hardly wait to hear what he would say to me, a fellow electrical researcher. What's the chance? At last he got the chance for somebody who understood to give some evidence. What did he say? Yes. God bless you, my son. Keep up the good work. It's a little disappointing. On yet another occasion, an Indian wearing a huge diamond in his turban appeared and said that he was the architect of the Taj Mahal. We also just wandered around blessing everybody. The most interesting thing that ever happened to me during those sittings was the arrival of an apple wart, which I was able to see from beginning to end. This is what happened. This was at the time when the red light was on. I could see everybody clearly. There was no difficulty in seeing. The medium wandered out from his corner, held his hands out like that, in front of Frank Turner, who was our host, sitting next to me. And we both had our faces within 1 foot of these hands. The medium looked just like this. He had coat and shirt on, and he held his hands out like that, and there was a sort of pink glow over the top. You know, I'm an electrical engineer, and I couldn't see what was causing this pink glow. There it was over the top of his hands. And I watched the pink glow rather carefully, and I could see something taking shape inside it. Don't forget, I could see everybody sitting around with their hands on their laps. There wasn't any mystery about the circumstances. I could see something taking shape inside it, and it gradually solidified, then it dropped onto the hands. The pink glow died away, and the medium picked up the object. It was a red rose, freshly picked. Wonderful thing with a scent, delightful. And our host expected this. He just took it and he put it in the vase. He had a vase already with water. My goodness. So that was one of the most remarkable experiences I've ever had. So most of those Sunday evenings we had as many as 30 or more full materializations. In one, I remember, we had an Indian, his squaw and the papoose. I held the papoose, and it felt rather like a bag of cold suet pudding. The seance usually lasted some 3 hours. The medium was absolutely exhausted at the end and had to be carried out to lie on a bed for half an hour. And, you know, if he'd been fraudulently dressing up, he would have needed a large portmanteau of clothes, and he came in with nothing. And the door was locked at the beginning, but I checked this, and I had, for what it was worth, searched the room. There was not a large room, and there wasn't any way to hide anything. All this was genuine. All those years ago, before and after I first came to London, I attended many other physical seances. At one, where the medium was tied to the chair, I entered after all the spiritualists were sitting down and when the red light was still switched on. We were all sitting in a big circle right around the edge of this room, and right in the middle, there was no furniture in the middle of the circle, right in the middle was a trumpet, just like those outside on the table, sitting there on the carpet. And then the control said he had a demonstration for me. Would I hold out my hands linked together? So I held out my hands like this. Remember, the light was on, I could see everybody clearly. The trumpet floated up from the carpet, and it went round and round my hands 6 or 8 times before it finally floated back under the carpet again. And that was while the light was still on. The light went off later on, this was controlled by the medium, who had a switch on the arm of this chair. And I don't have any comments to make on phenomena which occurred in the dark, or what otherwise mysterious, as I'm not a skilled magician. I'm not competent to make comments like that. I know a certain amount about magic. I mean, the president of the Magic Circle is a friend of mine, and I called him in when Uri Geller came to this country. Not that it helped very much. Well, I want to make a few comments on all that. That was very typical of what went on for a whole year. The first thing that happened was after a year or so, all the spiritualists fell out. I don't know of any spiritualist circle. I don't know what goes on in this society. But all those I've known haven't lasted a year. I've said that aura over there, Mrs. Smith just described it, it's not at all like you described it. So saying to the other medium, the other medium said, oh, well, I come on a much higher vibration. You know, a poor scientist is in real trouble. Well, first our host, as I said, he would have been absolutely horrified if I'd doubted anything. He wanted me to sign all sorts of things to say King George V came to this seance. And so on, and I was a bit doubtful about signing things like that. I mean, life's more complicated than that. But do I think that Sir Oliver Lodge would really behave like he did? You know, all those spiritualists were saying, good evening, Sir Oliver. Oh dear. And the others? Does King George V really have nothing better to do than attend seances in a little house in Battersea and bless us all and make vague references to his activities in the future and mention his suit? Well, so what is the explanation? This is something that is of enormous importance and what I wanted to make my theme this morning. That is the enormous creative power of belief and expression. I could go on for hours giving you all sorts of examples. In our ordinary daily life, showing you that what you expect to see, what you believe you will see, you do see and experience in other ways. I remember Soule's communication, you know, Sammy Soule, he was a president of the SPR some years before I was. He was a mathematician in the maths department when I was an electrical engineer at Queen Mary College in the University of London. Soule was having excellent communications with his deceased brother Frank through the London trance medium Blanche Cooper. Blanche Cooper would go into trance and convey information from Dr. Soule's deceased brother Frank. It was very good. And one particular bit was, do you remember the Frank said through the control, when we were little boys we went together hand in hand into a wood and we buried a penny underneath a stone. And our Soule said, I'd long ago forgotten that. We must have been about four when that happened. You know, any normal medium would say, how tough are you scientists? Come, if you don't believe, that's good evidence. What do you believe? Is there no satisfying you? Well, Soule hadn't been born the day before, and he devised a little experiment. It was this. He made up a character, a Scot. James Ferguson, he called him. You imagine all sorts of events in the life of James Ferguson going on in a little village in Scotland, how he was educated, the names of the children around him in the little school, where he was buried and so on, until he became very clearly existent in Dr. Soule's mind. And then he went back and had another sitting with Mrs. Blanche Cooper. And she went into trance, as usual, and the controller took over and said, good evening, Dr. Soule. I'm delighted to welcome you here again this evening. I'm happy to tell you we have another communicator on our side this evening. And the new communicator gave all sorts of facts to prove that he really had lived on Earth. And I give you one guess as to who the new communicator was. It was James Ferguson. And the only life he had ever lived had been in Dr. Soule's imagination. You know, most mediums consider telepathy to be a rude word, don't they? This is an example, surely, of what we would call telepathy. In a good seance, when a rapport takes place and everything runs well, there's a sort of merging of the unconscious minds of the medium and the sitter. And the medium, unconsciously of course, there's nothing conscious about this, unconsciously the medium is presented with the sitter's memory story, which is just down there in the unconscious. I've got my little model of a human being, which I'm using to describe this. And so the medium, a trained medium, has an unconscious dramatizing machinery. I call this George. George, down there in the unconscious, George is the part of us who finds the memories when we want them, rummages in the memory store, and pushes them up into the conscious mind. George dramatizes our dreams at night. He's awfully good at this. And he works in symbols very often too. And he has all our memories and perhaps sometimes other things which have come from deeper down in the unconscious. George does all this. George is the chap who has the complexes which require psychiatric treatment sometimes. George is the part of us that the hypnotist talks to. Now, you can change the physical world by talking to George because half of his job is creating this illusory physical world that we have. You'll gather I've got a rather different model of all this from the normal realism model. So that is what happened with Mrs. Blanche Cooper. Now another old friend of mine, I knew Dr. Soule quite well, we were colleagues, and Phoebe Payne, she later married Dr. Bendit and became Phoebe Bendit, a fellow theosophist. And she told me this. She worked with Hewitt Mackenzie at the London Spiritualist Alliance many years before that, That's now the College of Psychic Studies, of course. It was called the LSA in those days. They used to train mediums, and they had physical circles there. Phoebe Bendit told me, she was a medium herself, could see what was going on. She stood at the edge of the circle, and she used the creative power of her mind. Like many theosophists, she was a lifelong meditator. She used the creative power of her mind, and she can make, she told me, the next materialized figure be who she chose. She was standing at the edge of the circle, choosing the next figure, imagining what it would be like, and lo and behold, that was the next materialized figure that appeared. That's Phoebe Bendit's story. I'm giving it to you secondhand. But it certainly agrees with a lot of the experiences that I've had. Think of the fantastic creations you get in your dreams. I'm particularly interested in lucid dreaming at the moment. I've got 35 medical and, can you say, therapy members of the scientific and medical network who are on my list learning lucid dreaming. And wonderful experiences some of us have had. We think there's no particular mystery about dreaming. We know very little about dreaming. There are at least three levels of dreaming. I know David Fontana knows a great deal more about dreaming than I have, so I won't go on any further making an idiot of myself. But the important point I'm making is we ourselves have got to have personal first-hand experience of some of these altered states of consciousness before we can really talk sensibly about them. It won't do to do what so many of our fellow members of the SBR do, go out and find subjects. We've got to do it ourselves, and that's what some of us are doing. Other examples of belief structures, and then I'll stop and leave some time for discussion. Geller. The BBC and ITV and the radio programs have been ringing me up for years. Anything happening in this paranormal field? And I said, well, there's some years ago, there's an interesting Israeli in the States called Uri Geller. Why don't you invite him here? And they did. And we all know what happened subsequently. John Taylor's instant conversion in the non-test conditions of a BBC studio. Fantastic how anybody who can do that sort of thing can call himself a scientist. But I shouldn't have said that, should I? Well, keep the tape confidential. I've seen Uri Geller bend the key, but it wasn't his key. Arthur C. Clarke, Arthur Kersler, and I, Arthur Ellison, who were three Arthurs, all in Professor Hastid's lab. Before we went into the lab, Arthur C. Clarke said, see what you can do with this. And he pulled out his Yale key for his London flat. He put it on the back of Hastid's secretary's typewriter. He put his finger on the round end and he said, see what you can do with that. There the key lay flat. And we all watched it within a foot. Geller came up and he stroked it like that while we tore. And in about a minute, the end curled up. You could rock it to and fro. Arthur Clarke had to stamp on it on a hard surface before he could get in his flat. And then the mini goats. Arthur Kersler and I went to see a little girl aged 11. She had a little brother aged 13 up north, Darlington. On the way to the house, some very heavy, strong steel teaspoons. I could scarcely bend myself. I couldn't bend them doing this. And when we got to know the family, I gave one to the little girl and one to the little boy. Arthur Kersler watched the boy and I watched the girl. She held this spoon just below the bowl, with the handle coming down here, and her parents had taught her to keep her fingers well away in case they thought she was doing it normally. She kept her fingers well away, and I watched her like a hawk. And she bent it like that, and it flopped. In 1 minute, it flopped like plasticine. And I grabbed it quickly, and I felt it. It was strong, and it was cold, and it was normal, just as though somebody had bent it normally. I asked her, what exactly were you doing? She said, well, I was saying, bend, bend. And imagine he was going to bend, and I know it sometimes bends because I've seen Gela do it. What was the difference between her and me? Well, she was 11. She believed that this was possible. I've had courses on metallurgy and crystallography and strength of materials, and I know it's not possible. She hadn't had this condition. Well then, I've tested all sorts of things. Oh yeah, a fellow SBR member of ours, Batchelor, who died several years ago, but he was a psychiatrist in the West Country. He found that a temporary belief was enough to produce paranormal phenomena. He had a table with the instrumentation on it, so if anybody in the dark sitting lifted the table by pressing underneath it, it would detect it. It would be recorded on the electrical recording equipment. But if their hands were on the top and there was no upward fall table, then if the table went up, it was paranormal. And he found, by a good many years of work, that if somebody was given the job of doing this normally, so they would lift the table normally, somewhere into the sound, a lot of the other sitters would think it was paranormal. Oh, it's happening. You know, it's happening at last. And then up would go the table, paranormally. All sorts of things will happen if you have a strong belief structure. I was going to say, no matter what nonsensical things you believe, I don't know what the limits are, you can believe all sorts of nonsensical things. And if you really believe it deep down, maybe it's George's belief that really matters, you really believe it, you can do all sorts of things. All sorts of things will happen depending on your expectations and your belief. Well, one of the things, and I want to finish on this note, I thought long and hard about those physical phenomena, using this model of an etheric double carrying the vital forces. A lot of the medium's etheric double, according to this story, remember it's just a mental model, a lot of the medium's etheric double was used up in making the ectoplasm. There's very little left to carry his vital forces of life. Remember, this is just a model. So he was absolutely exhausted. Now, I've had experiences since of physical phenomena without ectoplasm. If you believe deep down sincerely that physical phenomena, just the same, will occur without ectoplasm, then I know from first-hand experience that they can do. And then the medium's there, in trance all the time, fresh as a daisy at the end. No exhaustion. Different mental model, different belief pattern. We have so much work to do in changing this ridiculous, materialistic, so-called scientific model that we're all educated to believe in here in the West. We've got to try all sorts of things. It's up to us who are open-minded, working in the paranormal, to be critical, constructive, read the literature, study these things, and try new things. And I suggest, Mr. Chairman, that's probably enough to stimulate discussion.
Well, I'm sure Professor Ellison has given you quite a lot to think about, and I'm very interested to hear his experiences. But I noticed that when he was talking about all these Indians that kept coming and going, and kings and queens and whatever else, there was no evidence of survival as such. It didn't appear to me. So that's something to think about. Now, has anybody got a question? We've got 10 minutes. Oh, I have one here, one there, one there. We did these three in that order, okay? First one, Margaret. How does Professor Ellison know that it was not ectoplasm? How did you know?
Well, there was no signs of it, of any foamy white substance, as I used to see in the Arthur Phillips sounds, as that was the name of the medium. Arthur Phillips and the other mediums I had experience of over the years used to have ectoplasm pouring out of their mouth and ears and various other orifices. In the case of Arthur Phillips, I suppose it may have been that he spent most of his spare time in the local hospital. It was a rather revolting smell. Rather like the central London tube line on a very hot, wet August afternoon during the rush hour. There was no mistaking it. Oh, yeah, you can see it in the dark sometimes. Yes, I often saw it in the dark. And the theory of the day was that you couldn't have materialization without ectoplasm. The point I'm making is that you jolly well can.
But if the ectoplasm had been invisible, what then?
Yes.
If the ectoplasm was invisible, or not visible to your normal sight,
then I wouldn't know.
You wouldn't know, would you?
I wouldn't know.
And very often it is.
But if the ectoplasm, using the old traditional model of the etheric double carrying the vital forces, if the ectoplasm uses that, extracted mostly from the medium, you remember the Golliger circle, all the photographs, then if the ectoplasm is mainly that, then the medium would be debilitated at the end. Very often they are.
Well, can I just point out an example I read recently here in Wales as a control called Dr. Lang. And some years ago, he said, do not walk between me and the patient at any time when I'm healing. By accident, somebody did, no ectoplasm visible. George Chapman collapsed on the floor and was in agony for weeks after, unable to work. No sign of it. Stephen Turok, I was at the house when he was giving healing to somebody, and a lady took a flashlight photograph, and his hands were burnt. No sign of ectoplasm whatsoever.
Yes, we do not understand it.
But there we are. That's right, that gentleman there was it?
Yeah, in actual fact, there's so many questions.
Only one.
Yeah. It could be possible alternatives to what you're saying in the mental leadership prior to materialization. If the lady, Trevi, I think you mentioned, created, you think, in her mind, that which materialized, can I suggest to you whether it's possible in your scientific approach that she actually was a receptive mind to channel what was prepared previous to materialization. In other words, she mentally had a free image of what would occur. You feel that is viable?
You know, there's an important fundamental point here. You're speaking of certain mental models as though they are facts. There are no facts. There are only these mental models. And you have a choice of a particular mental model, and your wording implied a particular mental model, rather than the mental model that I suggested at the time. So you've got two mental models there. One isn't a fact and the other isn't. One of them works better than the other one. So which one do you choose? What you do in the scientific method is you try to devise various experiments. We scientists supposed to be quite good at devising the right experiment to test the mental model. And if the mental model you're suggesting is better than the one I was putting forward, we would adopt that one. But there is no truth, absolute truth. There isn't such a thing. There are only mental models. You can say truth with a capital T is what we have a mystical experience when we're all one. In that state, we don't have much consciousness at all. It's just blinding light and complete bliss. We can't handle such an enormous information overload. Within these four walls, and with a limited amount of information, we can handle it and we're fully conscious. I think that's the reason for why we are in this particular physical world state. We're fully conscious, we're not an information overload, we can handle it, and life in this rather usury physical world, it's rather like a teaching machine. It presents us with all sorts of problems which we have to try and solve. And that exercises us, develops us, evolves us, until maybe eventually we shall be capable of being conscious at that mystical state. But until then, when all is one, the source of the good, the true, and the beautiful, until then, all we have is a series of mental models. And remember, we are not talking about the truth, we are talking about belief structures, mental models. There is nothing else for us at this stage of our evolution.
Even that which you've just said is a mental model.
Absolutely, yes, absolutely. Everything is a mental model. The Archbishop of Canterbury, the Pope, has mental models. They often don't realize this, and they think they're talking about the truth with a capital T. The leaders of all the religions of the world talk in this sort of way. A number of murders that have been committed in the name of the truth, I shudder to think.
Can I just have the last question for you, Yvonne, because we want to sort of move on?
Jolly good luck to you. I
remind
you, you're on the
right line. Yeah. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I've got to call a halt because I'll another speaker starting shortly. So I'd like to thank Professor Ellison for a most illuminating talk. And I'm sure that if you want to speak to him during the course of the weekend, he'd be delighted to speak to you. You buy him a drink and you'll talk as much as you would like.
I'd do
anything for a drink.